हरिओम। टेक्निकली फिनिश्ड थ्री अध्यायस एंड आफ्टर ए गुड अमाउंट ऑफ स्कोप गिवन बाय भगवान टू अर्जुन टू स्पीक द फर्स्ट अध्याय Bhagavan has let Arjuna speak his mind with the highest possible question in mind, a dejection coming out of a million-dollar question leading to Vishada, and then Bhagavan started answering. In answer, he first mentioned what is the goal of life? First thing first, you are a wayfarer. On the way, you saw a magician's game going on. You got glued to it. You got involved in that magician's game and forgot what were you actually supposed to be. So the first thing is to tell that, look, the game that you are enjoying is not the aim or goal of life. Because since birth till now, we have been following what is being taught to us by the world in material manner. Go to the school, have secular knowledge, earn money, get married, have children, possess certain things, feel good about it, dispossess certain things, feel bad about it, and make philosophy out of it and start telling each other that this is life. Make some stupid statements like life sucks. Make some statements like life is like this only. You have to accept it. None around, including ourselves, seem to understand what is the purpose of life. What is the goal of life? Why at all the life is there? Why am I born? What am I supposed to do? Am I sure what I'm doing is the right thing that I'm supposed to do? Am I making a mistake? And what is my parameter against which I check my activities that I am doing the right thing, a right action? I am leading a right kind of life. How do I know? If I compare with anyone else, quite possible, a million idiots do not make a wise life. The entire universe, led by the most stupid materialistic country, United States, is giving us certain parameters. Possess more, and be happy. So like blind followers, we all are following certain common diktats of material world, and we call ourselves that perhaps this is the life. But being Bharatiya, being a Hindu, we have a privilege, and the privilege is the access to the hidden secret of this question. Because the generations to come will ask a question: what is this life all about? What is the parameter of the life, a good life? Knowing fully well the dilemma that the future millions of generations will face, Lord has created that knowledge and encapsulated that by naming it as knowledge with Veda and handed it over way in the beginning. So he not only created the world, he also gave the manual of procedures for this world in the form of Veda. So whenever you buy an appliance, it comes with a manual. So this appliance called Vishwa came with a manual of operations called Veda. Now, if you use your own brain to put the screw here and there, the machine will not work. You will get trouble. So every time, refer back to the manual of operation, Veda. And in that manuals or the books that come normally as a supplementary material with an appliance, there comes a small paper which is called as shorter manual. Those who want to quick, or it's called quick guide. So of that manual, the quick guide is Bhagavad Gita. And in that Bhagavad Gita, before you start reading any manual, it is given that what should be the voltage, how you should read it, disclaimer, everything is given. Then the description starts. Similarly, in the manual called Bhagavad Gita, which is the shorter manual of a huge manual of procedure called Veda, the manual states, first of all, what is the goal of this machine? The appliance that you're going to use and you're going to be a part of it in the form of upabhoga. What is the goal? Why do you want to use this machine? For example, a washing machine is supposed to wash, it cannot cook. So you should be very clear about the goal of the appliance. Similarly, the Bhagavad Gita, in the second adhyaya, Bhagavan told us what is the goal of life. And the goal of life is Sankhya, which is a jnana. And Gurudev, with his divine brain, he gave us that commentary in which he states that you have to go under the arch called knowledge, Sankhya. Whichever way you may come, you can come from any path. You're free to choose a path. That will depend upon your swadharma, swabhava, etc., etc., your papam, punyam, etc. But your destination goal is to come to this archway called knowledge, pass under it, and then you will have a pratyaksha darshanam, a paroksha darshanam of yourself, or the self, or the atman, or the brahmajnanam. So the second adhyaya gave us knowledge about the goal, the Sankhya Yoga. It immediately leads to the curiosity that I know the archway. How do I reach it? Vasudeva understood. In the bosom of Arjuna, the next curiosity was, yes, I want to reach this archway of knowledge. Now that I know how to use this appliance, what are the means of reaching that archway? And the Lord gave extreme elaborate analysis of means of reaching the goal, and the means of reaching the goal is Karma Yoga. After talking about the goal and the means, the destination and the path, the Sankhya and the Karma, an intelligent student like Arjuna, who has developed what is called as an Aryan mind, Arya is the best or exalted. The one that has reached higher realms. At the higher realm, the dhi or the buddhi is in its prapullita avastha, in the blossom state of intellect, ability to absorb the knowledge, is maximum. A dull witted is anarya. The one who has exalted his intellect to a level which can absorb the higher truths, because truths are higher, the recipient of the truth has to be at a higher level. Such an exalted mind, such a pure mind, such a best mind is called Arya, and such minds existed in the entire world, in a specific location, in abundance. That is why the Hindustan is called as Aryavarta. It's not only the Aryan mind is here, but this Aryan minds have invigorated the minds of others. So Avarta, the cyclone of exalted minds, where they are is called Aryavarta, where we are born. Unfortunately, we are at the abysmal level of intellect because we are a pauper who happens to be descendant of a glorious king. So we happen to be citizens of Aryavarta, Brahmavarta, the glorious Hindu religion, not carrying a tradition even at the speck of what is needed. And that is why Gurudev says, for the Aryan mind, novelty in spiritual kingdom has no charm. So that is how now Partha is asking to Vasudeva, all right, you spoke to me about the goal, excellent speech, agreed. You spoke to me about the means, the karma, you told me how to do the karma yoga, what, how exactly should I be doing, because action is the only mainstay of me in this world. Take action out of me, I am not existing. As long as I am embodied soul, sharira deha dharana, till the time I fall, shiryate iti shiriram, till the time I fall, till the time I am holding the body, I shall be doing the karma yoga, and I should not be making any mistakes in doing it in a wrong manner. And the right manner was described in Karma Yoga. But what is the guarantee that this gentleman sitting next to me, yes, he is a revered person, he is a friend of mine, he is revered by many people all around, he is called Bhagwan Vasudev or Krishna by different names, but what is the guarantee that he is talking from a personal standpoint? I go to a school and I get impressed by the school teacher, and then I start believing and behaving the way the school teacher tells me. But what is the guarantee that the school teacher is the ultimate parameter? Similarly, Partha is now thinking, all right, things seems to be pretty bright. The gentleman speaks very well, but he looks like me. He is a human form called Krishna. What is the guarantee that he is the ultimate parameter of what he is saying? There is nothing beyond this. This is the last truth. What is the guarantee for that? And the guarantee is, if I'm able to cross-check what he says, that it belongs to Vedas, then I will accept it. That's why Gurudeva has put Vedas beyond Krishna. At the same time, Gurudeva has given an instruction that, sir, you are studying physics, chemistry, biology. In the similar manner, if you come and study Vedas, you will be mistaken. You are in the wrong way. Panditya is not the purpose of the scriptures. I remember all the characters in Mahabharata. No use, sir. I have Ramayanam Mukhodgatam. No use, sir. I know by heart entire Bhagavad Gita. No use, sir. It is not a waste, of course. It is an achievement. It is an example of a sattvic brain. But still, that is not sufficient. Why? Because Gurudev has given clear instruction. You have to have a cultural flavor, a moral dignity, and an ethical glow. And how can you get that? Only when you have spirit of reverence to the teacher, love, devotion, and friendliness are the emotional requirements. That means intellectual requirement is not the only thing that you need. Sir, intellectual achievement or intellectual requirement is like a stick to use while walking. But the feet while walking are the bhava, emotional requirement. So you walk with the feet and take the support of a stick. You study the scriptures with the emotions or the bhava and take intellect as a stick. Gurudev has given this warning. And only then the teacher drops his divine apparel. What is the divine apparel, sir? The apparel, the Trailokya Vastra, the creation is dropped and truth is made naked. Hiranmayena Patrena, that scintillating, dazzling cover, oh Lord, please remove. Why? Satya darshanam, so that I can understand the self. And that is why Krishna is here divesting himself of his workday clothes and putting on for the first time a full divine apparel of omnipotence and omniscience. Brilliant words by Gurudeva. Now he is already spoken about his workday clothes. The karma yoga has already been spoken about. Now he is talking about full apparel, divine apparel of omnipotence and omniscience, which you will get only when you have finished with wearing the first apparel. Then after earlier training in karma yoga, the means, you will start integrating your mind and intellect, because that is a minimum requirement for higher assimilation of truth. With this background, Bhagavad Gita expects us to enter into fourth adhyaya. How without Gurudeva's guidance we would enter in this fourth adhyaya? Because our dull intellect tells us that open the book, go to the first shloka and say, oh, Vivaswatamanu Ikshvaku, he gave it to him, he gave it to him, khalas, I am done with the first shloka. It is not so. Bhagavad Gita is not a storybook. There was a king staying there and then he went on hunting. No, sir. Every shloka is divine. Background has to be there. Mano Bhumika has to be there. Mano Bhumika is of great sages level, has to be held in the mind. That is how what Mano Bhumika should be there is given by Gurudeva in the introduction. With that Mano Bhumika, then Bhagwan starts speaking on Brahmarpana Yoga. Some people call it Brahmarpana Yoga. Madhusudan Saraswati Maharaj calls it Brahmarpana Yoga. Others call it Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yoga. Jnana, Karma, and Sanyasa. Pretty confusing. Karma Yoga, Karma Sanyasa Yoga, Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yoga. When you do any danam, you're doing a good act. Is it not? It is a good karma. But suppose you feel that, you know, I have got money and so I am doing this danam. It is good. Good to do danam. And I am doing this danam. So what happened? Karma happened, but it is not jnana karma. What is jnana karma? If you know the fundamentals of danam, that it was not mine. It came to me like a Ganga, the water was flowing. So I took it in a pitcher and gave it to somebody else. The water was not mine. Now what happened? The same danam has exalted itself at a jnana karma level. The one who acts in this world with fundamental aspect of knowledge, the one who has gone under that arch which Gurudeva has said, he still continues to do karma. His karma after jnanam is of a sannyasta yoga type, because neither the doership nor the fruits of the karma, none binds. The karma still happens. It is an examination in which a paper is written, results are never declared, and results are never bothered about. To explain this dilemma, first of all, Vasudeva says that, look, I am not telling something new to you, because truth can be told only by one way. Truth is only one. So its nature also only one. And it can be told only one. The methodology may differ. So Partha, you are doubting me as your friend, that how this man, what he's telling is true, how to relate it to Vedas. Is it the last parameter knowledge that my friend called Vasudeva Krishna has given? So first of all, Bhagavan says that, hold on. This is not first time I have told you. You may think that suddenly in this particular battle, I got some knowledge in my head and I'm trying to explain you, and my whole purpose is to make you fight this war. No. Imam, this which I'm speaking to you, Vivaswate, I first spoke it to Vivaswan. What is Vivaswan? If you look at the Nirukta of Yaska Acharya, Vivasanavan. Vivasana means darkness. Vivasanavan is dispeller of darkness. Sanskrit goes on two lines simultaneously. One side, the Purana will be there, Arthavada will be there. But deep inside the Garbhartha, the first I gave it to Vivaswan, who was the son of sun, light, bharga, prakasha, jnana. Jnana putra, dispeller of darkness again. So Vivaswan was the first. And moment I spoke to him, he did not remain dark anymore. So he became Vivaswan. What did I tell him? Yogam avyayam. I told this yoga. And Shankaracharya has been very, very specific on this. And Gurudeva has mentioned it. That whenever he refers to yoga, he is talking of jnana yoga. So jnana yoga is eternal, avyayam, imperishable. So this imperishable yoga, which was anyway imperishable, was first taught by me and came as a tradition, param, param. Param means one who reached. And then to whom? Param, the one who went beyond. From the one who reached to one who went beyond, param, param. Imam Vivaswate Yogam Avyayam Proktavan. I told. Who told? I, aham. So Partha, I'm standing in front of you. Don't think of me that I have come from Mathura, Gokul, Vrindavan. I did in this birth, in this avatara. But I am not restricted to this avatara. I came for you. I am actually from eternity. Why? Because yoga avyayam, and I told this, so I must be beyond that. Now it is confusing, Partha. I am before the knowledge, and you say knowledge is everything. How it is possible? Make the logical conclusion. Arjuna, I am only Veda. I gave Veda, Veda is me, and what I am is nothing but Veda speaking, and Veda itself gave it to this particular parampara, this Vivaswana. Then praha, taught prakarshena aha, specifically taught it to manuhu. Manu taught it to ikshvaku. Now vivasvan, dispeller of darkness, taught it to whom? Manu. Manu, mana plus uhu, one who thinks of everything, is called manu. Mana is to think. Mana, uhu, manu is one who thinks of everything. So dispeller of darkness, first was light, sun, because only sun can give light. So he gave it to whom? One who was having darkness, but he dispelled because of that light. So he gave it to Vivasvan or Vivasanvan. Vivasvan then gave it to Manauhu, one who was thinking. So only the thinker gets the light. And then he gave it to Ikshvaku. Ikshe, Isha plus Se in Sanskrit. Ikshe, Ikshe is protector. Ikshvaku, the lineage of protector, the one who could protect itself from the evils which bring the darkness. That is how the parampara started. And abravit, katham, to speak. Vachyam, these words are not used. Abravit, a bravit. Bra means what? Bra is to call. Chalo. You're not talking now. Talking is what I am doing. What is bravit? Chalo. You're giving a shout to move forward. Bravit. And it's a constant shout, abravit. So the one who has a knowledge or effulgence of knowledge, he gives that shout, he gives that call of the hour so that everyone starts moving and protects itself, ikshvaku, by learning it from the one who always thought manuhu, who in turn got it from the dispeller of darkness called Vivasvan, who got it from nobody else but Prakash himself, the sun. This is how the Surya Vamshi and Chandra Vamshi concept started. Surya Vamsha, Chandra Vamsha has been given as a concept in Hari Vamsha Purana and many other Puranas. So the story varies every place. According to Hari Vamsha, the Surya Vamsha started with Vaswat Manu, then it came to Ikshvaku, and in the Ikshvaku language, in the lineage, Raghu, and then Prabhu Ramachandra came. The solar dynasty of the Surya Vamsha was even taken by Jain Dharma and Buddha Dharma also. Gautam Buddha is Surya Vamshiya. Rushabhadeva, one of the Jain Tirthankara, is also Surya Vamshiya. If we go into Bhagavata Puran, Vivasvan is nothing else but Satyavrata Raja of Dravida Desha. In Bhagavata Puran, he is a Dravida Desha Raja, who was the son of Vivasvan, and he is called either Satyavrata or Vaivasvata Manu. In another few scriptures, out of the great seven sages, Brahma made Marichi, one of the great seven sages, as the first human creation. Marichi had a son, Kashyapa, who married Aditi, and they got a son called Vivasvan, Surya. This Vivasvan again got, he married with Saranyu. Saranyu was the daughter of Vishwakarma. Vishwakarma, the builder of the universe. Now this Saranyu, the daughter of Vishwakarma and Vivasvan, they had many children, one of which was Manu. And Manu started building the empires and the cities, etc. That is why it is called a Surya Vamshi, coming from the Surya. Incidentally and surprisingly, the same Manu is also called progenitor of Chandra Vamshi also. Chandra Vamshi, the Manu had a daughter called Ila. It's quite a mystical character. It's an androgyny character, Il and Ila. But that's besides the point. The Ila, the daughter of Manu, got married to Buddha, the son of Chandra. Chandra is Soma. Soma's son or Chandra's son, Buddha, got married to Ila. And then in that lineage, Chandra Vamshiya. Why? Because Buddha was the son of Chandra. And Bhagwan Sri Krishna is Yadu Vamshiya. Yadu Vamsha is Chandra Vamshiya. That is how the solar and the lunar dynasties were formed. Then subsequently, they were taken down by Rajput. So some Rajputs are Chandravamshiya, some are Suryavamshiya. Now the pride that the modern day Rajputs and everybody carry as a Kshatriya, as whatever a Chandravamshiya, Suryavamshiya is, to be carried in the legitimate manner as a Raj Rishi. King sages. So the one who has achieved the knowledge and is also the ruler is called a Rajarshi. Down the line, after these three names, Bhagwan Vasudev says, then Rajarushihi, one who could combine the prowess that they have along with the knowledge. That means a Jnana Yukta Rajatama Guna. The proper per utilization of Raja and Tamaguna, keeping Sattva Guna at the helm of affairs so that the karmas are performed in the manner as described in the third adhyaya of Bhagavad Gita, those were the knowledgeable people. So they knew Viduhu, Rajarshayo Viduhu. How did they know? Because of learning it from the forefathers, param param praptim imam. And as Himanshuji said, what parampara we are giving, we are not param. How can we give para? We are param in what? Material subjects. Look, son, buy the shares, make the money. You must buy Lamborghini. I wish you become so big that you have a beautiful palace for you to stay. Marry in that house where there is enough amount of money. Not one single advice comes from the mouth of the father that, son, you be knowledgeable and not the secular knowledge. Son, may Lord bless you and you understand Bhagavad Gita. Have we ever seen anybody giving a blessing like this? No. Dudho nahao puto phalo. Dudho nahao puto phalo. But what about the basic art of enjoying the tranquility, peace and happiness of life? That is the reason why psychiatrists are quadruplicating their business every decade. People are having everything at their disposal but suffering from bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, depression, anxiety. How much we think of future, getting out of the house is becoming difficult because of generalized anxiety disorder, the GAD. All this is our achievement, and the achievement is solely because the guidance coming from the parampara is missing. What is the point in teaching the children Bhagavad Gita? In this world, what is required is an excellent pre-medical test score. Even we were taught like that. So we did. We got the best score, went to medical college, became doctor, became this, became that. People said, how knowledgeable man. I felt I'm floating in the air. And when I came home, I realized I have achieved nothing. This man who left everything and walked up to Himalayas to meet the Pavan Maharaj ruled the world without having a single pai in the pocket. I have supposedly everything in my hand, but apparently nothing seems to be gained. That is because we are not a Rajarshi. We are only Raja. Rushi is completely missing. Rushyate, dispeller of darkness, is not there. And why this is so? Sakalena. Kal. Mahata yogo nashtaha. He parantapa. Scorcher of enemies such as passion, etc. Arjuna, even his incidents with the Urvashi is to be now kept into the mind when we read this name of Parantapaha. Parantapaha, the austerity to the extreme. And yet he was the Prince Arjuna, Rajarushi. So that Rajarushi is now getting it, not we. Bhagavan Vasudeva is talking about his own creation and the knowledge, the Guhyatama knowledge, etc., etc., that he's going to speak. Now he's speaking to Parantapa because he's Parantapa, that Parantapa. Arjuna is Rajarushi. What about us, sir? We are also reading with you, Bhagavan. I am also reading your Bhagavad Gita. We said, no, you are not Parantapa. Kalena iha mahata. Yogo nashtaha. With the passage of time, the world in general as samashti, but more important, with the passage of time of me as the dehadhari, every birth I'm going down. Yogo nashtaha. So I need to prop it up, and to prop it up, what we are doing, what we should do is, we must remind ourselves of this parampara, of this great knowledge, which Bhagavan himself, aham, I gave it to millions and millions of years back. And millions means what? Creation is a bubble that I create. Don't try to measure my age. It is beyond you. Beta, I have given you the intellect, which itself is so small. And it is very clear that I cannot be known by intellect. Even to see my shariram, my vistara, I have to give special eyes to Arjuna. What to talk of your brain? Your buddhi is santa, you cannot understand me. Then what should you do? You have to transcend your buddhi. How do I transcend buddhi? Make your buddhi sharper, sharper, sharper. Then what happens? A sharper and penetrating buddhi penetrates itself. And when it penetrates itself, I will drop the divine cloth. And the Hiranmayana Patran will be given. And Satya will come out. That is what, Arjuna, I am going to talk about. And that is the reason why I have named this as Brahmarpana Yoga. Everything and anything that you think you know, you perceive, your all vrittis, your mind itself, all that has to be dissolved as an ahuti. Because I call all this as Ajnana. But Vasudeva, I am PhD. That is Ajnana. Vasudeva, I am an IAS officer. Ajnana. I've got 6 degrees, Vasudeva. Ajnana. Vasudeva, I created such a big thing here. Ajnana. Vasudeva, I am President of the United States. Ajnana. All this, when you do the arpanam, ahuti, in the Yajna Brahma, Brahma Arpana. But how do you do that? What happens exactly? How do you exactly, Arjuna? That is what I'm going to speak in 4th Adhyaya. So do just to give you a glimpse of what I'm going to talk, I used these 2 shlokas. Now you are mentally prepared. Why you are mentally prepared? Because I knew you have a very limited brain, limited buddhi. So I sent my special emissary called Gurudev to you. Now that you are holding the finger of Gurudeva and read what he has written at the beginning as Upodghat or introduction to this particular chapter 4 or Adhyaya Chautha, now you can start walking. Alone if you had come, it would have been just a parade of the shlokas. You will not understand it. A baby, whenever he goes out, it is better to hold the finger of the elder so that they can safely take you to where you want to go. So Gurudeva is giving that finger through this commentary. We are supposed to hold on to it, not use our own great intellect. No, never. Why? You cannot understand it. So hold on to him, try to understand, and then try to understand. We are simultaneously trying to understand Vasudeva through the eyes of Gurudeva, then something will trickle down in this dhi, and then we will understand. Hari Om.